Greetings from St. Thomas Cathedral, Chennai, Mumbai. Friends, once again, we'd like to welcome you for our online service, especially on this glorious day of Trinity. We will be focusing on the theme of Trinity this Sunday. Trinity in the power of the divine majesty, to worship the unity, we beseech thee that thou wouldest keep us steadfast in this faith and evermore defend us from all adversities, who livest and reignest one God, world without end. Amen.
The first lesson is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphim unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me. This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle is written in the book of Revelation, chapter 4, beginning at the first verse. After this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, Come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne, and he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment. And they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass, like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four living creatures full of eyes before and behind. And the first creature was like a lion, and the second creature like a calf, and the third creature had a face as a man, and the fourth creature was like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures had each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne, and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Here ends the reading of the epistle.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The gospel reading this morning is taken from the gospel according to St. John, chapter 3, verses 1 onwards. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do the signs that thou dost, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, Ye be born again, and the wind bloweth where it bloweth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but cannot tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, How can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, Art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things, and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. This is the gospel of Christ.
The grace and peace of God our Father and our Jesus Christ be with you all. Even though we are not able to gather as a congregation to worship God in our church, we are able to worship Him in spirit and also feel the fellowship of our worshippers, our congregation members. We thank God for it. Just a word of caution, let us not make this online service into a performance. Let us pray. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This Sunday is Trinity Sunday. The Church observes this Sunday as Trinity Sunday. It is one Sunday in the year when the preacher invariably and unavoidably turns his sermon into a classroom exercise, trying to explain his faith as well as your faith in the Holy Trinity, one in three and three in one. Whether we desire a sermon on the Holy Trinity or not, we cannot and should not avoid giving a serious thought to the doctrine of Holy Trinity, a faith statement that we recite parrot-like Sunday after Sunday in our service. I believe in God the Father. I believe in Jesus Christ, God of very God of very God. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. I believe in God the Father, no problem. All religions believe in one God, the Father, and the divinity of God the Father is never in question. Similarly is also the doctrine of the Spirit, Holy Spirit. As long as the Holy Spirit is conceived as the Spirit of God, there's no problem. Problem arises only when we try to give the Spirit a place in the Godhead and an individuality in the Godhead of our God the Father. The major problem of the doctrine of Trinity consists in the divinity of Jesus. Jesus of Nazareth, whom the world recognizes as a wonderful person, par excellence. However, we Christians believe that Jesus is more than human. He is divine. Jesus is Lord, and we worship Him. This worship of Jesus is what causes problem for those who are non-Trinitarians. Piecing together these three irrefutable experiences, God the Father of Ancient of Days, Jesus Christ, who we know to be the one who brought salvation for us, died for us, was crucified, rose again, and appeared to his disciples and to many others, we firmly believe that he is the Son, is divine. And worshipping Jesus was a spontaneous response of the apostles to the risen and ascended Christ. When Thomas, whom we refer to as Doubting Thomas, wanted proof to believe that Jesus is risen from the dead, and when Jesus actually appeared to him, Thomas forgot all about his proof. He simply melted. He fell at Jesus' feet saying, "My Lord and my God." Similar thing happened with Saul. Saul, the bitter opponent of those who confessed Jesus as Lord, was on the way to Damascus to arrest Christians and to put them in jail. But before he could get to Damascus, he was struck with a blinding light. He instinctively closed his eyes, shut his eyes, terrified. He heard a voice and recognized that the voice was from heaven. So again, instinctively, he addressed the voice as Lord, not knowing who the Lord is actually. "Lord," he said, "who are you, Lord?" You can imagine the awesome fear that must have gripped Paul when the voice replied, "I am Jesus." And he opened his eyes. He could not see anything. You know the incident, so I'm not going to repeat. after he received baptism at the hands of Ananias, Paul, the fierce persecutor of Christians, became the fiercely persecuted one for the name of Jesus, for preaching that Jesus is Lord. He said, "What we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord." Imagine for a moment the once hardcore, rabid, high-class Jew who spat venom at the name of Jesus now saying, "Jesus is Lord." It gives me the shivers when I think of the conversion of St. Paul. In the context of our meditation this morning, what is of crucial importance to our faith in the Blessed Trinity is to note that Thomas, the other apostles, and Paul worshipped. They were strict monotheists, very strict monotheists, and they worshipped the God of their fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God who gave them very strict orders, a very strict commandment, "I am the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods before me." Yet, these hardcore Jewish zealots did not feel in any way uneasy when they worshipped Jesus as Lord. This is a point that we must all take note of, and the great basis of our belief in Jesus as Lord. These hardcore Jewish monotheists who believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob did not in the least feel that they were betraying the God of their fathers, not at all, for they strongly believed that the risen and ascended Christ is truly the image of God, that the full divine nature dwelt in Christ, in his humanity. If you read Colossians 1 and 2, and again in 2 Corinthians, he says, Jesus is the likeness of God. And then, of course, the words of Jesus must have, you know, flashed back into their minds with tremendous force. Jesus had said, "He who has seen me has seen the Father. I'm in the Father, and the Father in me." As I mentioned earlier, apostolic times, worshipping Christ Jesus as Lord was not a problem, was not a question. It was a spontaneous act, worshipping God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. However, they did not formulate a doctrine of the Trinity. It didn't strike them to do so at that time. It was only by the second, third centuries that the necessity was felt to formulate a doctrine about the Trinity. Sheer necessity compelled the third century church leaders to undertake this exercise, because different doctrines were being preached about the nature of Jesus Christ. Some bluntly refused that Jesus was not divine. Others firmly believed that Jesus was divine. And the sad part is the rivalry between those who believed and those who did not believe was so bitter, so much of hatred, that church historians tell us that Christians killed more Christians during those days than in the days of Emperor Nero, when Christians were persecuted. As I was thinking about this, I felt what a shameful and painful church history. To put an end to this law and order problem created by warring Christians, Emperor Constantine convened a council meeting of all the bishops and theologians in 325 at Nicaea. Constantine himself presided over the meeting, though he was not a Christian. He was only baptized as a Christian in his deathbed. At the council meetings, the church leaders argued their particular doctrinal positions vehemently, forcefully, very convincingly, quoting the Bible. The fierce and acrimonious debates between those who believed and those who did not believe in the divinity was really painful. Pulpit is not the place to go into these different doctrines. We have not the time for it. Let me give you just two examples. those who said that Jesus was not divine. He has no place in the Godhead. And those who did believe said, of course, he had a faith, he had a place in the divine Godhead. There were those who said, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are all one. But God appeared in three modes, just like an actor on the stage plays three different parts. He's just one, but he's playing three different parts. So this is just two examples to show the kind of arguments that were taking place. There was the group who said that Jesus was absolutely man. However, at his baptism, a divine being entered into him and was responsible or was the one who produced all the miracles and wonders in the life of Jesus. And just before crucifixion, this divine being left him. And so the one who was crucified was a simple, ordinary man called Jesus. Now, to come back to our council meetings, Emperor Constantine noted the hostility with which these church leaders spoke on the doctrinal issues. And he realized that they will never reach a consensus conclusion. So he therefore decided that the only way to bring these warring Christians, to stop these Christians from warring with one another, is to put the doctrinal matters to vote. Now, two people who dominated the debates at that time, one was called Arius, he was a presbyter from Alexandria, and the other one was an intellectually brilliant deacon whose name was Athanasius. Both argued. Arius argued his place, his position, very forcefully, trying to prove from the Bible that Jesus was not divine. He was human being. He was always the Son of God. He always referred to God as the Father. And he never once said that he is equal to God. These were some of his arguments. And then, of course, Athanasius proved even very strongly that Jesus is divine and that he is one of the persons in the threefold Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And he further argued that this is the apostolic doctrine, and that this is the apostolic faith and teaching. The end result of the debates was that Emperor Constantine approved the view of Athanasius. The doctrinal presentation of Athanasius was then put to vote. And the majority voted in favor. Emperor Constantine then made all the bishops and the theologians present there to sign the consent document, doctrine as it were. No more arguments, he said. Whether they agreed or not, all had to sign. Those who did not sign were sent to jail or they went underground. And that faith document is what has now come to be known as the Nicene Creed, which we repeat every Sunday at our Holy Communion service. Those who did not believe in the Holy Trinity are generally known as Unitarians. There are a large number of Unitarians all over the world today, including India, and we might come across them in our life sometime or the other. They call themselves Christians. They say that they are followers of Jesus Christ. And this is sometimes confusing for us when we enter into a conversation with them. The point is to note this, that they call themselves as Christians even though they do not believe in the divinity of Jesus Christ. These groups are like Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventists, the Mormons, United Church of God, the Pentecostal Church of God. These are some of the groups that are worshipping God as non-Trinity. We Christians, however, believe very firmly in the Trinitarian faith. We pray to the Father, we pray to Lord Jesus, we pray to God the Holy Spirit as we are moved to do so. And when I pray, I have never felt as if I am praying to three gods. Never. whether I'm praying to the Father or to the Lord Jesus or to the Holy Spirit, what I experience is simply the divine presence. And this must be true with you also. So what is of great importance to us is that belief in the Holy Trinity expands our understanding of God and corrects our vision of God, expands our understanding of God and corrects our vision of God. We see God and relate to Him personally in and through Jesus, the one Lord, the one who loved us and loves us unconditionally, the one who was crucified, died and was buried, and who rose from the dead and ascended into heavens, Jesus. Jesus is Lord. Our hearts know nothing can separate us from the love of God through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity. Another important and supreme gift of the Holy Spirit is that our Trinitarian faith enriches our worship of God. Whenever we worship God, we do not worship an unknown God, but a God who revealed Himself in flesh and blood, Jesus, born of Mary. When we pour out our hearts in prayer, we do not do so in vacuum, but we relate to God our Father in person, and even though He is infinite, omniscient, and omnipresent, He becomes present and almost visible to us in Jesus Christ. This personal faith, as I keep repeating, is possible because of Jesus Christ, our Emmanuel. God is with us. Our praise and worship, for example, being offered this morning, is not lost in the clouds, but they reach the heavens to blend with the voices of heavenly hosts saying, day and night, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With awe and reverence, let us then blend our own voices to the celestial singers by singing the first verse of the hymn, holy, holy, holy. Please join in the singing from the places where you are placed. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning a song shall rise to Thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The earth is full of His glory. The whole earth is full of His glory.
Beyond us. You create and sustain all things, but only by the power of self-giving love. We celebrate your creativity this morning, the risk and imagination you demonstrated in making such wild diversity in the world, the rhinoceros and the butterfly, the Himalayas and the spider's web, the earthworm and the human brain, There is mystery and joy at the heart of creation. We pray that we learn to treasure this amazing creation in which we live, not take the earth's resources for granted, and to share all her riches amongst all people, all creatures. Holy God, beyond us, we celebrate the mystery and the joy which is found in us. Lead us forward to pray. Son of God beside us, you never leave us comfortless. Bless those who are unwell, lonely, and in despair. In our hearts we name one or two such people. Son of God beside us, teach us gently to pray. Holy Spirit within us, fill, we pray, all those dark, dank places of this world with your warm life. We pray for humanity at large as the entire human race cries out for an end to the pandemic. So many cry out for food and a resting place, and those for whom hope is running low, be for them a summer breeze and a spring of fresh water. Holy Spirit within us, still our hearts to pray. O God beyond us, give us faith. O Christ beside us, give us peace. O Spirit within us, give us life. Ever one, sacred three, Holy God, the Trinity.
You
and with thy spirit,
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, who of thy own begotten Son and the Holy Spirit are one God, one Lord, in trinity of person, in the unity of substance, for that which we believe in thy glory. O Father, the same we believe in thy Son and of the Holy Spirit, without any difference or inequality. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, thou and blessed and true, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for thou thy tender mercy, did give thy only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and who suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by one operation of himself, once all wonderful, perfect and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute in this holy gospel, command us to continue a perpetual memorial of that of his precious death until his coming again. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants who celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, the memorial thy Son has commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory. And we entirely desire that fatherly goodness, mercy, and accept on high this our sacrifice with praise and thanksgiving, beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and the death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. We humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, who sent down thy holy and life-giving Spirit upon us and upon these thy gifts, that the bread which we break may be the body of Christ, and the cup which you bless may be the communion of his blood, and grant that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body in thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Let us all pray together, and here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee. And although we may be unworthy for our many mortal sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our mountain duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. As our Savior Christ has commanded and taught us, we are bold to pray. Thank you. Let us pray. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed with his precious blood, that we may evermore dwell in us and heal us. Amen. Draw near and receive the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in most heart we thank thee for that thou hast also aided us, who have duly received these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and the blood of thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and doth assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, that we are very members incorporated in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and also heirs to hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. We most humbly beseech thee, O heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Glory to God on high, and we are pleased.
Let us pray and receive the blessing of God in faith. Grant, we beseech thee, Almighty God, that we hear by faith and all thy undivided Trinity. May by these gifts which we have received be made worthy to behold thy glory in heaven, where thou livest and reignest, one God, world without end. Amen. The peace of God, passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst to you and remain with you always. feast, love, and to feast, love, and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.